Hello and welcome to Nula, a weekly program produced by the NITV News team. Nula means here, there or everywhere in the Darug language, and that's exactly where we'll take you as we check in with mob around the country for a look at the week's news from an Indigenous perspective. Coming up, the Tiwi traditional owners taking an island delicacy to the world. History has been made in Victoria, with the state's Indigenous representative body formally declaring it's ready to begin negotiations with the government on a statewide treaty. In a ceremony this week, the First Peoples Assembly of Victoria gave its declaration to the new independent treaty umpire, with those present acknowledging the generations of activism and work that led them to this point.
A message imprinted on a kangaroo skin, bearing a nation-leading declaration. Victoria's First Peoples Assembly is finally ready to negotiate treaty.
Our journey towards equality and justice is deeply rooted in a long history of Aboriginal activism in Victoria. And over generations, our people have collectively marched and protested for our rights, and today we continue that fight.
The declaration was given to members of the new Independent Treaty Authority at the organisation's official launch today. It opened with a smoking ceremony and a performance by young dancers. The gathering was also graced with an emotional performance from renowned musician Uncle Kucha Edwards. And the Treaty Authority had its own gift to exchange with the Assembly, a shield. The Authority's chair emphasising the importance of treaty in forging a new future for First Nations people.
There is a gaping wound that has not been healed in this country. We deserve to prosper, and the people of Victoria deserve to have strong Aboriginal communities.
The Assembly saying a statewide treaty needs to give community real power over decisions made about them.
We're very much focused on some structural reform to make sure that decision-making of government about First Peoples can be transferred to First Peoples, that we can hold government accountable, and that we can provide direct advice to government.
The state of Victoria is enthusiastic about coming to the negotiating table with First Peoples because we know that when First Peoples thrive, all of Victoria thrives.
It's been 6 years since Australia's very first treaty legislation was passed here at Victoria's Parliament. Having taken this next historic step today, the First Peoples Assembly of Victoria will begin community consultation, with hopes that the state government will be ready to begin negotiations by November.
We encourage all Victorians to follow along with the First Peoples Assembly, see what's happening, find out the information, and join us on this journey.
A generation-spanning journey that may finally have its destination in sight. Cameron Gooley, NITV News.
Traditional owners are hoping to share a Tiwi Island delicacy with the world. The Muntiyupwi clan are part of a world-first trial in black-lip oyster farming, which they want to take to a global market in the next 2 years. Reporter Emma Kellaway travelled to see the farms in Warramyunga in the Tiwi Islands.
Hunting on the water is a natural way of life here on the Tiwi Islands.
Been growing up eating them oysters, all the bush food, yeah, from the sea, yeah, like oysters, turtle, digong, yeah, fish, crab, lots of things in the sea.
For the Muntiyupwi clan, they're looking for new ways of harvesting traditional foods, starting with the black-lip oyster.
Chip him off the reef, and for us to get them black-lip oyster is good, you know, for people and how to see different thing growing. Yeah.
It's a delicacy that grows wild on rocks fringing the two main islands of Melville and Bathurst. Now they're being farmed in cages floating offshore where the crocodile populations are high and dangerous.
Yeah, crocodile, a lot of saltwater everywhere.
The green algae, a key element in the oyster diet, is abundant in these waterways. Twice a fortnight, they are flipped to dry and inspected for new growth. The hatchery production is critical to the process. Currently done out of a lab in Darwin, researchers collect spawn from wild oysters, feeding them on a formula of algae until they're big enough to release.
I think that having a product that has a provenance, it's grown on country by traditional owners in a remote destination in the Northern Territory, is a fabulous story.
The Tiwi Islands is one of four top-end communities with trials underway, work supported by Commonwealth and NT government grants, but with hopes of taking the blacklip oyster to a global market in 2 years, more investment is needed before the project wraps in 2026.
Hope will grow and we can send them in Darwin and all over the globe, you know, and they can have a taste of our oyster that grows from our water.
Better for them kids, you know, learn about the oysters, you know, be great, you know, for them little ones growing up in the future.
In Warramayunga, Emma Kellaway, NITV News.
To the week's sports news now, and Game 3 of this year's State of Origin series lived up to the hype, with New South Wales winning the decider against the Maroons 14-4. The fallout from the brutal contest will continue to be felt in the NRL competition. 9 players have been charged by the judiciary after an all-in brawl, and one Blues star is likely to miss the rest of the season.
Party time for the Blues in the Maroons' backyard. The wild celebrations continuing well into the night.
It was very late. I'm getting a bit old to do those things.
But with his Origin coaching career in its infancy, Michael Maguire has already managed to crack open Fortress Maroon. Bloodied Bradman Best barging over for the first try of the match in the 65th minute.
Yeah, one of the toughest games I've played. Coming up here, it was so good to get the win.
Blues halfback Mitchell Moses capping off his remarkable performance with the match winner.
Moses straightens up for there. Moses to
be able to live that moment and, you know, it come true is the best feeling ever.
To get it done on the big stage up here, and you know, when we're down 1-0, he came into the team and, you know, got us home. He was great.
But it's likely the last game Moses will play this season after suffering a serious injury.
We think he has torn a bicep.
The start of the match was ferocious.
Oh, and now the extra boy a bit on the receiving end.
Eventually, tempers boiled over.
Oh.
Nine players have been charged by the judiciary. Blues lock Cameron Murray is facing a 2-week suspension for getting involved while he was on the bench.
There's no need for you to get involved in the bench for 10 minutes.
19th man Homoli Olukawatu is facing the same suspension for his involvement, but that didn't stop the Blues from winning a decider at Lang Park for the first time in 19 years. Maroons fans are still coming to terms with the loss.
We're still Queenslanders. We're still Queenslanders.
New South Wales, the kings of Origin football for 2024.
And there was another Origin this week. More than 1,000 young mob from around New South Wales taking part in a unique sports carnival, Nations of Origin. The event kicked off with an opening ceremony on Darug Country in Western Sydney. Representatives from the 25 nations competing carried banners depicting their regions. Now, in its 10th year, the tournament sees 146 teams competing in netball, gymnastics, basketball, and rugby league sevens. And one of the teams travelled almost 5 hours to be at the Nations of Origin. They've come from Dubbo and Wellington in Western New South Wales, and our reporter Ricky Kirby visited Wellington to see how the Wiradjuri team had been training for the games.
Two towns, one team. These young people from Wellington and Dubbo are representing the Wiradjuri Nation at Nations of Origin. Over the week, they will be competing in basketball, gymnastics and parkour.
So we're taking two boys and girls teams away to Sydney, and we've been preparing over the last 10 to 12 weeks, every once a week training sessions. All the kids have been here every week. There's actually not one kid that's actually missed a training session, which is amazing. They're all really committed with each other. I think it's creating that community unity that they want to be part of this project and they want to be a part of the journey.
I like to represent our town
and to show how we actually do it.
Each of them have earned their spot with over 80% school attendance and no negative dealings with police.
I just hope when they finish that they're proud of what they've achieved and they put our town out in Sydney.
Yeah,
because we're small but we're proud.
I feel pretty proud and excited to play with my brother and also my mate, so yeah, feels pretty good. We've got a pretty decent team. Hopefully we'll put up a fight, play, maybe hopefully get a couple of wins and all that. But yeah, no, I think we do have a good chance of winning.
The competition, an opportunity for Indigenous and non-Indigenous young people to come together to represent and celebrate Aboriginal culture.
Feels really good just being able to share our town's culture again. I like having a strong culture, so showing that we're capable of being great people from just a small little town and with not all the big resources that a big city might have, we can still do crazy things. So being able to just represent it with these nice shirts and everything, it's just a great feeling.
Ricky Kirby, NITV News.
And those are just a few of the stories the NITV News team covered this week. For more Indigenous news or to catch up on stories that you may have missed out on, visit the NITV website or check out our social media. I'm Natalie Arnatt. Ha 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 ha